thanks for joining us. Steve, Coll is with me today. And Steve has a really interesting career as a journalist and writer. Spent a long time at the Washington Post, but more recently has been writing about a region of the world he knows well from being a foreign correspondent, Afghanistan, Pakistan. We'll talk about that. Winner of two Pulitzers, and is now the dean of the Columbia Journalism School. So Steve, thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
Let's start right off with the new book. You wrote a terrific book, Ghost Wars, which covered kind of what was going on in Afghanistan, Pakistan, and in the CIA leading up to the attacks September 11th. And now you've written a sequel, which picks up on September 10th, right before the attacks, and goes right through more or less today. Why did you feel, obviously that period after, the Ghost Wars was unique because there hadn't been a lot of reporting about what happened before the attacks. Why did you feel the need, what did you feel you could add to the period which has got a lot of coverage, which is the response to the attacks?
Well, I wanted to go underneath the surface of the struggle that we've had to achieve our objectives in Afghanistan. And I thought that while you're right, there was a lot of coverage from day to day. There were still layers of history, contemporary history, that really hadn't been excavated or put together in one place. And because, you know, hundreds of thousands of Americans went to Afghanistan after 2001, hundreds of thousands rotated through in the military primarily, but also in other services, you know, in the embassy and as aid workers, as journalists. And I think there was a lot of goodwill that the international community brought to the project of trying to reconstruct Afghanistan after 2001. And a lot of people who invested years of their lives in that, I think, came home. If they came home in one piece, they came home wondering, was it worth it? Why have we not been able to achieve all of the goals that we set out to achieve? Why did the Taliban come back? Why are we in this grinding stalemate? And I thought, with Ghost Wars, my purpose was to try to give Americans and Afghans and Pakistanis a reliable, detailed history of how we had gotten from the Soviet invasion to September 11th. And this time around, it was the same. I wanted to work inside that triangle, United States, Pakistan, Afghanistan, to give Americans, but also Afghans and Pakistanis, a reliable account of why we're where we are 17 years in. So
you write quite a bit about the lack of clarity around the mission in Afghanistan. And in the wake of the attacks, it was pretty obvious, I think, to most Americans and certainly to the CIA that we had to go in there, at the very least, to stamp out al-Qaeda. But having done a successful military mission at some level, a lot of people fled. We missed some people on the way out, made some tactical probably mistakes there. But then 16 years go by where we're kind of shifting and evolving our approach to the war, as it were. What do you think accounts for the fact that we still, to this day, at some level, are still grappling with why we're there and what we're doing?
Yeah, no, it's a central question. And part of the problem as a writer, historian-ish writer in this volume is that the mistakes are so repetitious, and the arguments and the kind of misjudgments are repetitious across three administrations, really. But it's been interesting on the book tour. Sometimes when I go on the radio, the host will play a clip of President Bush's, George W. Bush's speech, I think September 20th or something like that, to Congress, where he's setting up the war to come. And I think we probably, those of us who were adults at that time, probably remember the sense of unity and resolution and purpose that the country felt, and also fear about what was coming next, but also, you know, a sense of, okay, we're in this, we're going to be determined. But it's so interesting when you listen to his words, and there's lots of resolve in them. There's also this problem of what are we doing about the Taliban? that's it. With the benefit of hindsight, it's notable. He doesn't say we're going to war with you no matter what. He says you still have a chance to get out of the way. There were no Afghans on those planes, right? The Taliban had never attacked the United States. Al-Qaeda attacked the United States. You could say the Taliban were morally or legally complicit with the attacks because they had provided the sanctuary, but it's not even clear that the Taliban leadership knew about
it. I was going to say your research found no evidence that they had foreknowledge of.
Yeah, it's possible, but I think the best judgments are that they really didn't. And there's this very interesting set of scenes involving the Taliban leadership after this last offer is made by the Americans. You know, you can still do these things, close these camps, give us bin Laden and so forth. And Mullah Muhammad Omar, the emir, former emir, well, I guess then still emir of the Islamic Emirate, gathers his counselors around him. And their advice to him is, boss, you know, this is coming. We're going to lose our government. Al-Qaeda is not worth it. They're not our friends. They don't cooperate with us. It's sort of like they had this house guest that was turned out to be absolutely more muscular and more difficult than they
certainly
could do anything
about.
Certainly wouldn't leave. And it's not even clear if the Taliban decided to force them to leave, who would win those gun battles. They were the kind of shock troops of the Civil War, and the Taliban had used them for that purpose. But anyway, a lot of his advisors said, you should consider this. And it's Mullah Omar who says, I can't turn a Muslim guest over to American justice. I just can't do it. And if we have to lose our government because of my principles, our principles, then that means God is telling us that we need to go into exile and reflect on what we've done wrong. And I'm willing to lose everything. And so he did. But he left after the Taliban fell, he left NATO, because it was a NATO war, an international war, with the same question that President Bush had voiced on the eve of the attack, which is, where do the Taliban fit in this equation? And what is our post-war strategy? Are the Taliban really the issue? And if you see through the loss of the peace that they had established in 2002, partly a failure to grapple with the Taliban as an indigenous force in South and Eastern Afghanistan, to have any strategy to reincorporate them into the country's post-war politics, the hubris of not learning the lessons of the Second World War, for example, in Germany and Japan, that when you defeat an enemy as thoroughly as NATO defeated the Taliban in the fall of 2001, sure, you can hold their leaders accountable, you can put war criminals on trial, but you cannot hold every foot soldier, every sergeant, every lieutenant in the enemy force accountable for having participated in the war. But that's what we did. We sent hundreds of Afghans to Guantanamo. We imprisoned many more in even worse conditions in Afghan prisons. We drew no distinction between the Taliban and Al-Qaeda, even though any rational analysis would hold that there was one. And we did the same thing in Iraq, by the way. When we got to Baghdad, we dissolved the Ba'ath Party and the Iraqi army and seated the Sunni insurgency. So it was a common problem across two wars. And then you get fast forward to 2009 when the Obama administration is trying to figure out how to swing from Iraq, which has been calmed relatively by the surge into Baghdad. He's campaigned on a promise to fix the war in Afghanistan, has campaigned on a theme that the Bush administration got bogged down in Iraq, fighting the wrong enemy. Al-Qaeda is the real enemy. Al-Qaeda was still active internationally and dangerous. And so the idea was, let's go to Afghanistan and deliver on that promise to get after the real threat. And you go through this history of strategy making during 2009, and the same contradiction comes up again. So they're very thoughtful, you know, both administrations, very thoughtful people wrestling with what you would hope your leaders would wrestle with if you're sending young men and women to war, which is, what are the vital interests that we have in Afghanistan that justify the potential sacrifice of life and limb that we're asking our military to make in this war? And they go through this long set of discussions about the answer to that question, very sobering discussion, and they come up with two answers in 2009. So one is Al-Qaeda. They're still a threat to New York City and other places. And the other is the security of Pakistan's nuclear weapons. We don't want them to fall into the wrong hands. But think about it. In 2009, neither of those problems is in Afghanistan. Right? Al-Qaeda had fled at Tora Bora into Pakistan and was almost entirely across the border in Pakistan at that point. And Pakistan's nuclear weapons are in Pakistan. So So these are smart people. They realize there's a kind of logic problem here. We're sending 100,000 American soldiers into Afghanistan to pursue vital interests that are located next door. So why? And then you get into this logic that, well, if we don't, then the Taliban will advance and they'll create another sanctuary and Al-Qaeda will come back over the border into Afghanistan. Okay, not an implausible scenario, but kind of an indirect reason, tangled reason to fight a war involving American sacrifices of that scale. And that was just kind of typical of the way this problem of what are we trying to achieve and where recurred. And so did the problem of what do we think about the Taliban. Last point on this, you know, every American commander who's gone over there, just about every American commander who's gone over there to run the war, military commander, will say in public, this is not a war that's going to be won by military means. It's not a war that's going to end with a total military victory. Our purpose is to push our adversaries to the negotiating table so we can negotiate a stabilizing political settlement with at least most of the Taliban, if not all of them. And yet, you know, again and again, we resource the war at a very high level and don't really have a complementary political or diplomatic strategy to achieve that goal.
You know, we have a new president, not so new anymore, but he campaigned against the war in Afghanistan and then gave a speech last summer kind of not doubling down, but saying we're going to stay longer. You wrote a piece in The New Yorker that said, he was criticized by, obviously, the Taliban, which says, you know, you're making the same mistake, and by Steve Bannon. You had a great line, said, just because Steve Bannon and the Taliban agree doesn't mean it's necessarily wrong. You know, where do we go from here at this stage? You know, there's obviously a much scaled down U.S. presence, but similar strategy in many ways.
Yeah, I think, I mean, to be fair, there are some points of departure in the Trump administration's approach. One of which I think is semi-material, but the way they would see it is that they are doing a few things differently that they think will be decisive. One is they're signaling to the Taliban and Pakistan and everyone in the region that we're never gonna leave unless we get the job done. Now, I'm not sure anyone in the region believes that, but we are now more explicit about that. There's no clock. The second thing is, you know, loosening rules of engagement to toughen up the battlefield against the Taliban. I mean, that I find much less convincing considering that there are 10 to 15,000 international combat troops there now. And at the peak of the Obama administration's efforts, there were 150,000, 10 times as many. And the CIA every 6 months, starting in about 2007, has created these so-called district assessment classified maps. Afghanistan's divided into about 400 administrative districts, and every 6 months the agency would collect 25 different metrics, you know, roadside bombs, control of the roads, assassinations, so on, and they would color code every district in Afghanistan, government control, Taliban control, contested, independent control, and put different colors on the maps. People love these maps.
I mean, yeah, they were kind of cool. You don't have a visual of one, but, but in writing the book, it seemed like an interesting way to think about the problem.
Yeah, but the reason I mention them is that those were created in 2007, and I know they're still being, you know, reviewed in various forms today, and they really haven't shifted.
They don't look any different.
They really haven't shifted. And so the idea that you could fight a counterinsurgency war with 150,000 international combat troops and not move the map, but you're going to move it with 10 to 15,000 and some looser rules of engagement and some signaling about, you know, your resolve, it just doesn't seem persuasive. And I fear that it's a case of, you know, doing the same things over and over again and wishing for a different result. The one departure that is, I think, more significant is the decision by the Trump administration to suspend aid to Pakistan as an effort to persuade them to do something about the sanctuary that the Taliban and others enjoy in Pakistan. I think that's I can understand the logic of that policy. I don't have any disagreement with it. I think if it's not linked to a negotiating strategy or some kind of political strategy, it's unlikely to change Pakistani conduct.
So a lot of the people you write about in the book have actually sat here and talked about leadership. We've had Mike Mullen in, Stan McChrystal, David Petraeus, I think, and some of the civilian leadership as well from the State Department and the CIA. Mike Hayden, I think, was in here. What did you learn, you know, looking at the scope of this history over going back to the 80s, what did you learn about leadership and about the decision-making?
It's interesting. I think one thing that repeats in both histories. The Ghost Wars history has, you know, sort of maybe more elements of American success in it, although it ultimately ends in a tragic and, you know, possibly preventable attack. And the Directorate S history, which is just kind of flows through, is a little more dispiriting about the lack of success in leadership and decision making around the Afghan War. But in both cases, one thing, I'm a creature of Washington, right? I spent 20 years at the Washington Post. You spent a lot of time in Washington. I have covered our government. I have managed coverage of our government. I spent a lot of time as a researcher on those two books and others trying to unpack how decisions were made, really made, you know, interagency and in the Situation Room or in the Eisenhower Executive Office building. Who wrote the briefings for the decision makers? What did they debate? What was the basis for the decision? Where did leadership figure? Where did the president's thumb tilt the scales? Where did he defer to his advisors and so forth? And one thing that's so striking is just how stovepiped our massive national security system is. You have, I mean, if you're the president of the United States and you want to direct all of the leverage of the CIA, the Pentagon, the Joint Chiefs, the Secretary of Defense, the Treasury Department, the whole machinery that we have to influence the world, if you want to point it at an objective, you really have to be forceful.
So you're running a journalism school in addition to your historian, writer career. At a time when journalism's under assault, it's under assault from the tech industry, which has sort of destroyed its main source of revenue, advertising. And it's under assault because journalism has been somewhat democratized, and that a lot of citizen journalists out there, and there's a president who's actively disintermediating the press as best he can. So what do you think the role of journalism going forward is, and what is the mission of a school like yours today?
The main change that challenges journalism now is the rise of computation and the need to train journalists to carry out their professional reporting function in a world where you have to be able to do the math in order to hold power accountable. And that's a really exciting opportunity for journalism education. But the events of the last 2 years, the kind of attacks on the press, the populism, the rhetorical kind of over-the-top tonal attacks and so forth, it's actually been very helpful to us with our students. A few years ago, it's a mission. Yeah. Well, not so much mission, but also it's more. I don't think of it as mission. It's like what Marty Baron, the editor of the Washington Post, who's quite an able editor, I think, said at one point. He said, "You know, we're not at war. We're at work. This is what we do." And when I first came to the school 4 or 5 years ago, I found among the young people who enrolled that there was an understandable confusion about what journalism really was anymore. Citizen journalist, isn't everyone a journalist? Or am I a journalist because what I'm carrying around in my phone? And we would work very hard to emphasize, you know, basics, history, ethics, reporting, street reporting, talk to strangers. We started to get to the point where we would stand up at the beginning of the school year and try to do a scared straight speech, which is, if you don't like to talk to strangers, get your money back before you can. But, you know, now that doesn't, and there would be times in those years where you'd be with a student and they'd be, say, with a scholarship donor, and the donor would say, "Well, why did you decide to come to Columbia?" And the student would say, "I wanted to tell my story," and my heart would sink. And I would think, you know, unless you swam here from Guyana, we're not interested in your story. We're interested in other people's stories. We're interested in how the world works, how power is exercised, how decisions are made. And that kind of drift, that sort of solipsism, it's gone. Everyone's sitting up, you know, sitting up straight, taking notes. How do I do this again? And now they have questions. How do I, if I'm a person of color, how do I cover white racists at Charlottesville? Do I interview them? How does that work? Mm-hmm. And the faculty will take a question like that and feel, okay, now we're talking, because yeah, there's an answer to that question. And you know, look at the Vice documentary or any number of other achievements in under pressure of professional reporting in a tense and difficult and sometimes polarized environment. But yeah, we know how to do that work, so we can help them.
Steve, thanks for joining us so much and for covering all that ground.
Appreciate it.
And good to end on an optimistic note.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Thanks for having me. Thanks.